We're really lucky in the fact that dried plums are a crop that can be easily grown in a sustainable way. That's because the fruit has been around for literally thousands and thousands of years. They often talk about farming being an art or a craft, and I think there's a lot of truth to that, because in order to grow dried plums, for example, there's a small cadre of farmers here in California and other countries. We're only talking about in the hundreds, not even in the thousands in California, that have a long association with growing this crop. Farmers really need to use a little bit of science, use a little bit of common sense, and thirdly, some intuition that they've developed over the years. And they combine all those attributes, and that's really the craft. When you grow dried plums, as we call them nowadays, the difference is that I have to think about the goal. And the goal is not to grow fresh plums per se. It's the finished product. So I'm always thinking about that when I'm out in the field. I'm thinking about, how do I get to the end, which is a really sweet piece of dried fruit? It's not as simple as just growing fruit for its size or shape or color like you do with fresh fruit. You need to think about how you're going to impart the most nutrition and sugars into that piece of fruit so that it's going to be nice and plump and sweet. And we're growing these orchards for the long haul. It's a 35-year decision at minimum. And there'll be trees in my orchard that I remember everything about them. I will spot them. I will know they're different because of their structure. I remembered when I pruned it when it was 4 years old and what the problems were. And I have a direct interest in seeing that tree do well.
At the beginning of the year in a tree's dormancy, we are having to prune the tree, manicure it. We want to do the best job possible. And then depending on the crop and the set, whether it's heavy or light, we may need to thin the tree to get the proper size. And then there's many decisions to be made as far as fertilization and water management all the way up through harvest.
Growing up, I think the farmer, the tool was a tractor. You know, everybody talked about their tractor or their pickup, and what kind of tools that they had in their pickup. And anymore, I would think that the tools that are necessary now is your smartphone with all the various apps, so you can check water moisture and wind temperature and air temperature and wind speed.
So. And even the foremen in the field now, I mean, they're all relying on their smartphones as far as when to irrigate. I mean, it used to be we had a soil probe and you dug a hole and you looked at the soil, felt it, whether if it was moist or dry.
There's nothing more satisfactory than to walk over to that bin of prunes after they're dried and looking at them and see just a beautiful product, large size, and that tastes good, and that I know somebody is going to enjoy at some point in time.
When you see your product in the bin and it's dried and it's sweet, it's got great flavor and size, you say, hey, that was all worth it, all those years I spent in the field to get to this point. There's a great sense of satisfaction. You get pumped up.
Harvest is a 1 month process, but for 12 months, you know, we're caring for these trees and we're giving them water, we're giving them nutrients, and you know, nature's giving them sunlight, and they're growing, you know, a perfect fruit.
Sugars and pressures are primarily the two indicators you're using to know when to start a harvest.
About August 10th to the 20th is pretty typical prune harvest time. And we usually like the prunes to get up to around 24 bricks. It's the amount of soluble solids in a prune.
Years and years ago, all the prunes were picked up off the ground. Now they're mechanically shaken. They never hit the ground.
Once they're harvested in the field, they're taken to the dryer and where they're run into what we call a dip tank. It's a large water tank where this floats the leaves and debris out, washes the prunes up, and then they're spread onto trays. From the trays, they're stacked up, about 6 foot stacks, with they hold about 2,000 pounds of fruit on a cart of trays. And from there, they're run up into tunnels. And our temperatures on the drying tunnels will be anywhere from 185 to 190 degrees. But my dryer, we dry for an hour and 45 minutes. One tray will come in. We have nine cars in a tunnel. And as one is moved in, one is pulled out. And so this takes, this will be about 16 to 18 hours that a tray of cart of prunes will stay in the dryer tunnels, and then it's pulled out. And then from there on the carts, they'll be put onto a track and brought back into the dipper machine, which unstacks the trays, and this scrapes the prunes off, and then these go into a bin for storage. After storage, after the prunes are set for about 10 days, then we have to turn them. When you go into the dehydrators, you're drying this product for 16 hours at 185 degrees. So you any pathogens or anything that's there will be eliminated in that process. Plus, on the other side, when we bring it back into the plant and we're steaming it, you know, we steam it up to 212 degrees, you get another kill process. So you have a very safe, high quality product here to eat.